Hey guys, what is going on? Welcome back to another video. In this video, we're going to be talking about the specification of a motor that deals with the current draw from that particular motor. We're going to look at the difference between continuous as well as peak current draws on a brushless motor. We're going to also look at what this specific specification means to us and how a motor manufacturer comes up with it. And then we're going to find out how not to use this specification. As a side note to this video, I'm working on a project that deals with a radio control car's tire, trying to understand the physics that happens within that tire from all the different types of tires you can get for any particular radio control car. We're looking at the difference between the actual size of the tire as well as the weight of the tire and how that impacts the overall performance of a radio control car. So if all goes well, look for that video to come out sometime Friday. So now let's get back to what we're talking about for brushless motors. Now, the first thing I have to point out is that there are two specifications that you can come across for a motor, and that could be a rating for current that is in either a continuous form or a peak form. If it's a continuous rated value, this is the values that we try to use most commonly on the channel, and you can use this value for most of the different types of radio controlled vehicles that you possibly can run. And all that continuous value means is that you can pull this amount of current for the continuous amount of time that that battery would sustain a charge. That essentially means to us the entire capacity of a battery pack. And if you want to stretch it from there, a continuous rating theoretically means that it could run at that power level for a limitless amount of time. And that should also be true for that specification to be real. The peak value specification for a motor is going to be a little bit different because it does represent the amount of power that you can pull from the motor, but it is going to be tied with time. Unlike the last specification where it is a continuous amount of time that we can actually pull some power, the peak duration is going to be a lot smaller. Typically in RC motors, you're looking at anywhere between 1 second and 15 seconds of operation under this sort of peak value that is recommended by a motor manufacturer. Once that time has elapsed, then you would have to go back and resume something less than the continuous current maximum for that motor. Otherwise, you can cause damage to the motor through excessive amounts of heat that builds up when you're operating at those power levels. Now, what do you do if you don't know the rating on the specification sheet that you read for current is continuous or a peak value? Well, there's a couple things that you would be able to do. And the first one might be obvious, and that is to send an email to the motor manufacturer asking if that rating is either continuous or is a peak value for the current maximum of that motor. The second thing that you can do is you can actually compare a motor against a known motor. For example, if you know that motor A has a maximum continuous current rating of 50 amps and it is of the same physical size as the motor that you don't know if the rating is continuous or peak, and you also have the same similar KV value, then you can use those two motors as a comparison. You take a look at that 50 amp rating on the motor that you know is a continuous rating, and you compare it up against the current value for that motor that you don't know if it's continuous or peak. If you ended up seeing that it's a difference between 50 amps of the motor that you know is a continuous versus 100 of the one that is a peak value, this would suggest to you that something doesn't appear right for both of those specifications to be continuous ratings. So this is just an idea to give you a very quick result rather than waiting for that email to return to you. Now let's get into talking about exactly how a motor manufacturer comes up with these values and what they actually mean. So essentially, if you're a motor manufacturer and you're designing a new motor, the next step after you've designed it is to go ahead, take that motor, build it, and then test run it. When you're test running that motor, this is where you're trying to record the values of performance that you're getting out of that motor so you can have some real-world results. If you don't have the real world results, you're not going to have some accurate data to represent and demonstrate what your motor can do realistically. The way you would do this is you would assemble your motor on some sort of test stand, and then you'd have a load placed on that motor, and you'd operate it under that load at a certain specification to see how much current you can pull in order to not exceed your maximum temperature that you're going to rate the motor for. Essentially, what it comes down to is a motor manufacturer is going to record a certain amount of current that you can pull from the motor while it is not exceeding a certain thermal temperature. As long as it doesn't exceed that thermal temperature, then the motor manufacturer may feel comfortable in order to represent that maximum current as a value within their data set. A couple different environmental specifications that can actually impact the amount of current that you can pull from the motor could be something as simple as the temperature that that motor was tested at. If that motor was in an ambient temperature of 20 degrees versus 25 degrees, that will make a subtle difference in the actual results you get. Another different characteristic for the specific parameter that that motor was tested at is the amount of cooling airflow that is passing over the surface of the motor. If that cooling airflow was increased, you'd be able to remove more heat from that motor, which would allow the motor to pull more current. This would essentially allow the motor manufacturer to place a higher current maximum because of the increased airflow. A bunch of these factors all add up and play in on exactly how a motor manufacturer comes up with that maximum value. Here's exactly what the specification for current is not. So if you have a motor, for example, we have a couple motors here on the table. If you have a motor that is rated for, let's say, 50 amps, let's assume both of these motors are rated for about 50 amps of continuous discharge. That doesn't mean you cannot pull 51 amps from this motor or even 300 amps from this motor. Just because the motor is rated for 50 amps of continuous power doesn't mean you can pull 300 amps from it. Now here's the thing, if you do try to pull 300 amps, you're gonna have to have the best cooling that anybody on the face of this world has ever seen in order to make this operational. And if you have never achieved that before, you are going to be able to bet that the motor is going to fail due to exceeding the thermal capabilities of the motor. When it comes to current within the motor, it is essentially up to you as the hobbyist to make sure that you're going to stick within the limitations of that motor. The way that you do that is, of course, by controlling the amount of load on that motor. If you're driving a radio controlled car, you're going to be able to play around with the gearing so that you can reduce the amount of load if you're seeing you are pulling too much current for that specific motor. Well guys, I hope that ends up shedding some light on the ratings of our brushless motors. The key highlight in this video is that if you have a 50 amp rated motor, that motor is not just going to operate from 0 to 50 amps. If you demand more power out of that motor by simply loading the motor higher than the amount of power you expect to pull out of it, that motor can very well exceed 50 amps and pull more power and potentially burn out. So keep that in mind as you're sourcing all of the different components and, of course, as you are actually running the tests for your motor. You get that new motor, you throw it into your radio control vehicle, and then from there what you can do is you test the vehicle by running it around for a short duration of time and measuring the temperatures. What you want to see is maintaining the temperatures within the operating limitations of that motor. If that is all okay, then you're doing well. And that will be it for this video. Thanks a lot for watching. Like the video if you do, hit that subscribe button if you haven't, and I'll see you in the next one on Monday. Take care.